know. And what's great about, I feel like, at our shows, a lot of times what happens, there's a sense that, like, everyone in the room understands what we're sort of singing about, and even if it's something just sort of trite and fun, like Changing or, you know, Gasoline or something, or if it's something like really kind of that has some larger themes to it, like All at Once or Innocence, there's a sense that we're all just kind of in that room of light, you know, together, and everyone's just kind of out with it, like, well, fuck it, man, like the way you would with your buddies or something. It's
right,
like, where you're like, fuck it, man, we've been through some shit, everybody's been through some shit, and you've got, like, good friends you've had for many, many years, and you can have a beer, and you know some shit about him that, like, you're like, that is fucked up, and, like, if his mom knew that shit, it would be all fucked up, or, like, if that was, like, some, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Like, these are the things that he's living with, and, like, you're his buddy, partially because you don't give a shit. And he
right.
likes that about you, and he has the same shit on you, and like that's where we live, right? And like what's starting to happen in everyone's shows is just there's the same that similar sense of like, well, fuck it, we're all here together. We've been through some shit. It's good to just kind of be out with it, and then it just, you know, like most things in the light, it's not so bad. It's not
right.
that big a deal. You know what I mean? It seems like, yeah.
You goof off
whatever.
For a sec, you know. But going back to now the title of the record, I mean, with all these stories you just said, that's almost like what the title of the record, you know, All at Once. Again, like everyone together all at once, everything's
yeah.
happening all at once. Do you, now when you're making this, do you look for those double meanings, or is it just happens to work out that way? And you, fuck, man, I'm jealous of your writing. As a writer myself, I'm jealous of your writing. I mean, do you ever think, like, oh, well, you know, this is a great metaphor, this is, you know, this will work here, I hope someone picks
yeah.
up on this?
Yeah,
or is it just,
absolutely.
Is it, fuck, you're that good that it's natural, you know?
I think the cool thing to say is, like, yeah, it just sort of happens, but, like, nothing in this band, you know, ever comes out that way, so let's just be honest about it. It's more the Airborne way, right? No, it's work, you know. I'm really trying to communicate. We as a band are really trying to communicate. And, like, you know, it's probably the thing we're better at than, like, a lot of the, like, we're never going to be the Strokes. We're never going to be the Kings of Leon. We're just, like, not in that mold of rock and roll bands. We're just kind of doing a different thing.
But if it happened, would you let it, though? I'm not to cut you off, but if it did happen, would you let it happen, or would you just?
I just don't think it would. I just think that the things that we're selling, if you want to call it that, you know,
yeah.
are different, and I don't know if they have that kind of. It's not. I don't mean to say that, like, that's bad. I love especially, like, old Kings of Leon, and I even like that new Strokes record. I think it's good.
Right.
I'm not trying to diss on them at all.
No, I think they're
great rock and roll bands. I'm trying to just say that, like, we're not really cut from that mold. We're not trying to be. We don't want to be. It just kind of doesn't have much to do with us. And, like, I think that, like, the honest way of, like, approaching this is, like, our to say that, you know, yeah, it's work. I mean, I really, really hoped that people would, you know, would become lost in these ideas as much as we did. We made the record. We got really caught up in these ideas. We spent months with them, tearing them apart and putting them back together and thinking about, well, what is fusion? Because we were trying to fuse different genres at certain points. Like, okay, what does that mean? And what works about that and what doesn't? And then as a writer, like, okay, this idea, if you say it this way, it means this thing. But if you go back and revise it and say it this way, it kind of adds a different nuance to what I'm saying. Okay, so let's do that because that's better. And then it's just like, each one of those pieces is like part of, like, you know, it's like building a house. If you look at the house all at one time, you're just like, fuck, that's a lot of steps. How do you do that? But then, you know, you pour a foundation and then you build, like, a basic sort of weight wielding structure, and then you add some drywall, then you put plumbing in, and then you put a roof on and you put a floor down. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If you think about it. And that's kind of like making this record was, just getting really lost in each one of these ideas and trying to create an engrossing experience that seems seamless for others. You know, we want people to put headphones on, listen to this record start to finish, and get lost in it the way that we did. That was really our goal. And there's nothing was by accident. Everything's intentional.
Right.
And everything, frankly, it was a lot of work. I mean, like I said, I wrote 50 songs, and then each one, we did 38 full demos of those songs, and then we did pre-production where we probably played most of those songs six different ways until we found the way that made the most sense. And then we were very, very particular about how we recorded it with Dave Sardi. And just the whole thing was, you know, a really engrossing experience.
Very cool. Now, you had mentioned, like, working with the legendary Dave Sardi. What was it like working with him on the record?
I'm very happy with his work. He's a fucking talented guy. You know, he's cheeky as fuck. Like, really a fucking sarc- God damn. So, you know, he would say, I think he would say that shit, partially because it's just in his personality to take the piss out of people. But
right.
I think what he was going for was, you know, I think he really cares about the final product, and he didn't want us to be like, all right, we made a record, we're hot shit, we don't have to work on this. He really wanted to challenge us to make the best record that we could and really think through why we were doing what we were doing. And, you know, like, for example, he would challenge me as a songwriter. Like, I wasn't used to being challenged as a songwriter. I would just kind of, like, write what I wrote, and, like, that was sort of became a thing, and that was that. And, like, I'd written a song, you know, and he told me at one point that he was like, that song needs a middle eight. And I'm like, what the fuck's a middle eight? He's like, well, explain to me what that was. And then he's like, go listen to a bunch of Elvis Costello. He does those really well. So I did, and then I wrote a middle eight for the song Strange Girl. And then
okay. That was my next question. What the fuck is a middle eight, then?
Yeah, so it's an eight-bar phrase, which is a piece of music which kind of is different from the rest of the song. Generally comes between the second and third verse, and in like a, you know, it informs the chorus so that the next time you hear the chorus, you interpret it slightly differently. It deepens the meaning of it when it's done well, and it's a really good piece of music that only happens once in the song. It's
wow.
It's akin to, like, you know, structures of sonatas or something. Like, a sonata has like a four-part structure where the third part is there to, like, I think it's the minuet's two, rondo's the third. It like reinterprets the major motifs, or like, you know, a three-act structure of a play or a movie or something, where it's like, you know, the major conflict at the end of act two starts act three and has to be resolved in order to end the movie, right? So like that same idea, or, you know, joke telling goes in threes. It's something about human storytelling that, like, it just sort of works. And so anyways, he had this real focus on classic songwriting, and he was like, got me to think like that and stuff like that, where it's just like, he was on some next level shit, you know, and he really, really cared about the final product. And we butt heads constantly. I mean, we would fight in the studio, like, he and I would just at it every single day for months.
Really?
But, oh yeah, but then at the final product was one that we both, you know, stood by and felt proud of.
Now, here's the thing, though. I mean, you're fighting with the producer, essentially. It's like an actor fighting with his director. Do you ever feel like, oh, fuck, like, maybe we made the wrong decision? Or,
yeah.
You know, like, that hostility, does that deteriorate and, you know, defer you from what you want to achieve and what you
want? Well, I mean, it would if it was just like out and out hostility. I mean, we weren't getting in like fist fights or anything. That would
right.
Be, you know,
no, I
it
understand.
It was more like very opinionated people who care very much about a final product. And I think,
of course,
you know, in situations like this, a band on its second record, it's like you don't want like some cult like mentality where you think everything you do is roses and gold, you know, like where it's like, you know, you want to be able to actually like, okay, what are we doing here? And like he was really good at making sure, you know, we didn't think we were so hot shit that we didn't make any mistakes or anything like that, and really pushing us. And it's a much better record for it. I mean, he really made us get detailed about every single part on every single song, every single sound that created every single part on every single song, and then how they all fit together to form, you know, a kind of pastiche that tells a story. I mean, that was something that, you know, we were thinking a lot about, and then we knew he was good at that, and that's why we hired him. So, I mean,
right.
No, it was great. He was great.
Now, you know, still on the same record, last fall you had toured with the Calder Quartet. Do they appear on All at Once?
Yeah. So they're on the song All at Once, another song called All for a Woman, and they're on a song called All Everyone. There's three All songs. They're on all the All.
It's all good, then. How did you link up with them initially?
Andrew, who is in the Calder Quartet, is Anna's brother.
Oh, wow. And, okay, then that explains
that. Come from, like, a very, like, musical family. And
wow.
I think initially we decided we'd ask them to play with us, I think, I want to say on Letterman. I think, you know, we were like, hey, let's try and do this with the string quartet. Why not? And then it went really well that we ended up doing a few different late night performances with them, and then eventually doing a tour with them, and then
right. They're
on the record, and now, you know, they're actually opening for us at our like just with their own concert at the Ford Amphitheater show here in LA.
Cool.